Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I'm your host, Jason Turner. In this episode, I want to talk about vector bool. If you've been around C++ at all, you know that people think this thing is really weird. So let's discuss why it's weird. Be sure to check out the video description for links to my ebooks, printed books, Patreon, and GitHub sponsor page, as well as news about upcoming events that you might be interested in. Okay, so why it's weird? Well, let's look at the standard description of vector of bool for a moment. Now, the standard explicitly gives a specialization for vector of bool. It lists it in its own category, its class vector bool. And it says to optimize space allocation, a specialization of vector of bool elements is provided. And that's all that it really says. And it says down here, there is no requirement that the data be stored as a contiguous allocation of bool values. A space optimized representation of bits is recommended instead. And it also has a few things with like flipping of bits and whatever. What does that mean? Why a space optimized version? Now, a bool can be represented as a single bit. A single bit is, you know, just 0 or 1. The bool type, however, takes up 1 byte, generally speaking. If I just do this return size of bool, I'm going to get 1 returned from main. So if I've got an array of these bools, I'm going to get 15 bytes returned. Now that's 15 Boolean values takes 15 bytes. Those should take 2 bytes. That can be stored as 15 bits. And generally speaking, we're going to say a byte is 8 bits. That should be stored in 2 bytes. So vector of bool tries to be the space optimized thing. And we're going to try to kind of peek behind the curtain here and see what vector of bool is doing for us. So I'm going to look at capacity and size. So I have pushed back a single value and I get that the size is 1, but the capacity is 64. Well, that kind of makes sense if each block of data that it's going to hold is a 64-bit integer that it can pack these bits into. And so that means I'm going to have to pack in a whole lot of bits if I want to actually see the capacity of this thing grow and change in any meaningful way. Now, what we'll see instead, if I were to take this from vector of bool to say vector of int, and this code should compile, is we see this geometric growth. So I've got 3 elements in here and a capacity of 4. If I comment out these, then I should see a size of 1 and a capacity of 1. It's not going to allocate a bunch more memory than it needs to. So when we go to vector of bool, we are observing, and I just noticed that I was pushing integers back into a vector of bool. I really should not have been doing that. We are observing the fact that it is packing these things into a 64-bit integer. Let's do something slightly more reasonable. Interestingly, we did not get any warnings from the compiler about that whatsoever. So that is incredibly helpful. So say I want to get a pointer to the front of this thing. Now I'm going to print out the first value also. Okay, so the size is 3, capacity is 64, the value of the first thing is 1. Now, if this were a vector of integers, it would be perfectly reasonable to say I want a reference to the front thing. And we're going to get this cannot bind non-const L value reference nonsense. Let's go ahead and take this back to integer again. And if I reassign the first thing to equal to 0, then we should see 1, 1, 0 printed. We have three elements in here. So 3, 4, 0. Okay, so 3, 4, 0 have been printed. And I can assign this to any value that I want to, and we can observe this last thing change. So if I take this back to a bool, there's no way in the C++ standard to get a reference to a single bit. That just simply doesn't exist. It would, and if you think about it, it doesn't make sense. Right, how would I even represent this? How would I say, give me a reference to, I don't even know, like how would I represent this? I could do a bit mask. That doesn't make sense. I can only reason about values and bytes. There's just simply nothing for me to type here. Now I could create a bit field. Now, if you're not used to the syntax, it's going to look very strange to you. But what I have said is that there are three objects in this struct called B1, B2, B3. They are all Booleans, and they are represented by one bit. In this case, I have it represented by 3 bits. So this is a bit field. So you might think I could initialize this object and then say, okay, I will use this to get a reference to one of the bits, like that. And we get a different error here. Cannot bind bit field to a bool reference. So there's just no way to use a single bit in C++. So what the standard implementers have done for us is they've created this proxy object. So now things start to behave quite a bit differently than we would expect. I have this thing, which looks like it's a copy. In fact, it is a copy. It should be a copy. And I can assign to it. And if I assign to it this value 0, we expect 0 to get printed here in a moment. And it did. Right here in the bottom right. Because this is a proxy object that internally contains a function that knows how to set the appropriate bit in this packed set of bits that we want. So that's weird. And then where it starts to get annoying, if I want to write code like this, I can't, because this thing that's returned, these begin and end iterators, these proxy objects, are temporary objects. I cannot bind a non-const L value reference to a temporary object. So I can do this, but then I can't assign through it because it is a const object. So now we just moved the error down here to line 14. And I can do this, but this starts to look really weird. You're like, well, I'm assigning to this thing. Is that actually doing anything? And it is. Line 14 is doing something because it's assigning through the proxy object itself. So what you end up finding is people who will write something like this, which is a forwarding reference. And it says, you know, you can bind to anything, so I'll just do that. Now, this use case is extremely rare. It's very few different types of objects that return back a proxy object to you. So for that reason, I recommend that you only use this forwarding reference syntax for your arranged for loops in the cases where you need it. I would say in a normal situation, you should do something like this if you intend to mutate the value. Use a non-const reference. And then you can mutate the value in an expected way. And you can fall back to using R value references in the case where you've got a proxy object involved. But that's like why vector of bool is weird. And we can dig into this a little bit more. So I've jumped in here in GCC's version of B vector, which is their vector of bool. We can see in here this bit reference type. And when you do an assignment of it, it actually has to check which byte you are currently trying to access or which value inside this packed bit structure. And then it does some of these bit set versus bit clear against the value that it needs to mask on. And there you go. It's got a mask that's stored in here, so it knows which bit to access and it knows how to set it or clear it appropriately. So that's what makes vector of bool weird. It's not just a collection of data like every other vector type. It is a vector of packed bits, or at least it's encouraged to be. It's still not required to be by the standards rules. So that's just an interesting note. Also interesting to note that the specialization is in fact enabled for context for use in C++ 20 if you have a need for such a thing. Although I think most people agree that it might not be the best tool in your toolbox for working with bits if that's what you need. So thanks for watching this episode of C++ Weekly. I hope you found it at least slightly enlightening, and be sure to subscribe.